graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Superpowers, Year 2, Part 2, by Drew Hayes. Narrated by Jonathan Lee Taylor and performed by a full cast.
It was Halloween. It was a party. And three Lander students sat immobile in a booth under the red lights as their friends looked on anxiously.
You sure they're okay?
Nick's right eye twitched, and Mary's throat bobbed. It was the first signs of stirring either had shown in the last few minutes.
About time.
Rich Weaver was bringing Nick, Mary, and Alice out of the state he had put them in, and it was taking longer than he expected. Vince and Sasha were getting quickly up to speed on why their friends seemed to be catatonic. While neither Vince nor anyone else from Team One was particularly pleased with the events, it didn't surprise any of them that Nick had riled Rich to the point of demonstrating his abilities.
I assure you they're fine. The place I sent them is like the home base of their subconscious. It's built to be safe and comforting. If anything, they're resisting because they're enjoying it too much. I could jerk them out, but it might be a bit jarring.
Herschel nodded.
I can vouch for that. Last year when Roy snapped free of the illusion you put him in, it took half an hour before he was sure of what was real and what wasn't.
That's precisely why I'm being more delicate. Shouldn't be much longer now, and their relaxing little vacation will have to come to an end.
Inside the church, inside Nick's mind, it was the polar opposite of a relaxing vacation. Mary gagged as the crushing pressure bore down on her windpipe from behind. Powerful hands yanked her into the air and let her dangle, her small feet kicking helplessly.
This isn't real. You don't need air, so stop struggling.
That thought was of little comfort as she felt a burning sensation begin to creep across her chest. She groped behind her, and her fingers brushed something she thought was skin. She drove her fingernails in. Suddenly, Mary felt like she was flying. Her backbone struck the wooden top of a pew, and red dots blurred her vision. When they finally cleared, she could see Nick glaring down at her.
You fucking bitch!
His face was twisted with hate, his eyes burning with a dark golden light. Three slashes of blood trailed down his cheek. Mary clawed uselessly at his hand.
What fucking right do you have? I tolerate your intrusions, and you think that means you're free to look at any damn part of me you want?
Nick jerked her up and slammed her back to the wood. Mary tasted blood.
Don't you say a fucking word. I don't want to hear it. There's no going back from this one, Mary.
His grip grew even tighter.
What happens if I die like this? Will some piece of my mind be eternally obliterated? Maybe I won't wake up at all.
Stop it!
A younger version of Nick leapt onto the arm, pinning Mary down, and began trying to wrestle it away. Nick's face flickered with uncertainty. It made sense. Here he was, literally fighting with himself.
Why do you care?
I don't want to hurt anyone else I care about.
Her?
She's my friend.
You don't have friends.
Mary felt the pressure ease as Nick's shoulders sagged a bit.
We don't have friends. I don't have friends. Friends are for marks. All I have is the family.
She's our friend! Please, let her go!
Nick looked at the two of them, the golden burning in his eyes subsiding. He slowly relaxed his hand. Mary fell to the floor in the aisle, spasming as her body tried to recover.
Note to self, try not to die by asphyxiation. There has to be more pleasant ways to go.
Eventually, she regained enough strength to sit up. At the front of the church, both Nicks were standing by two coffins and the twisted, charred mass of a destroyed car. The older one was hugging the younger one close, like a big brother. Mary couldn't remember if she'd ever seen Nick hug anyone before. She struggled to her feet and walked forward slowly, not sure of what to say to the man who'd just been on the verge of crushing her windpipe.
This never happened, you know.
What? What didn't?
All of this.
Nick made a sweeping gesture, taking in the space.
I mean, there was a funeral, of course. I just wasn't in attendance. They insisted on keeping me at the hospital for several weeks after the accident.
Wait, you were in that?
Mary came closer and stared at the hunk of metal. The idea that anything could have walked away from it was beyond belief.
I was. They couldn't believe I'd gotten through without some sort of damage, so the doctors had me under strict observation for some time.
That's still terrible, not letting you say goodbye to your parents.
Nick shrugged.
Given that I was only 4 months old at the time, I guess they figured I wouldn't really know the difference.
4 months old? What about him?
He's the age I was when I realized what had happened.
Mary shuffled awkwardly. There was only one place to take this conversation. She decided to press on as carefully as possible.
He seemed to think you had something to do with the accident.
I probably did. In all likelihood, I'm the reason my parents are dead.
You were a baby, Nick. You couldn't have caused something like that.
Nick turned around slowly and looked at her. His lean face seemed almost gaunt in the wavering light of the candles. For the barest instant, his eyes sparked golden.
Couldn't I?
Mary felt a horrible, wrenching sensation as she put it all together.
That's the memory you were looking for. You wanted to see if it was really you who caused the crash.
How did you know that?
Jerry told me.
Huh. That actually raises more questions than it answers. Never mind. I think I'd rather not know for now. It doesn't matter. As soon as I felt you here, I came running.
Nick, most people never show any symptoms of their abilities until 3 or 4 at the very earliest.
Most.
The single word said volumes. Rather than continuing the debate, Mary walked the rest of the way to the front and wrapped her arms around Nick's torso.
What are you doing?
Hugging you.
Why?
Because I can't think of any other way to make you feel better.
Thank you.
Nick looked up into the earnest, upturned face of his 8-year-old self.
Yeah, thank you. I suppose. And I guess I'm sorry for my reaction.
Mary released Nick, stepped back, and smiled.
Don't worry about it. The way I see it, you only imagine trying to kill me, and it would be pretty unfair of me to hold a grudge against your imagination.
When they woke up, minutes later, there would be much to talk about. Things that would be conveyed through red thoughts and covert nods. For now, for only this moment, there was peace. And in this room, through that door, down this hall, peace was something that hadn't been present in a very long time. Alice's mouth felt dry. She blinked, nearly overwhelmed by the red lights and loud music. Things had been so quiet only seconds ago.
I think she's coming out of it.
The voice was familiar. Alice turned and saw tousled blonde hair atop a curious expression.
Here, drink this. The other said they had some wicked cotton mouth.
Alice accepted the glass of water, surprised by how cold it was to the touch. She drained its contents and began shaking off the jumbled feeling in her head. She looked over and realized why the voice had sounded familiar. Jill and Will were sitting at the booth with her. The others nowhere to be seen.
What happened?
It seems our teammate, Rich, took some offense at Nick's questioning of his skills. Thus, he decided a demonstration was in order. You have our sincerest apologies.
Alice stared at the table as things began to mentally realign.
Right. He put us in a dream.
It's a bit more complex than that. A lucid hallucination would be a better term, but for current intents and purposes, yes, he put you in a dream.
Alice nodded. It was all coming back to her. Nick's insults, the spa, the pedicure, the man in the suit who had approached her.
The truth is, I'm here on behalf of your mother.
Papardale.
Jill didn't notice, but Will saw Alice's grip on the table suddenly tighten, her knuckles beginning to go white. She turned her face up and forced a smile that was more like a snarl.
And where is Rich? He's with the others. They all went to the bar to get drinks. We volunteered to sit here and keep an eye on you.
Thank you.
Alice rose from the table and headed through the crowd.
Where?
Don't. Just let her go. Also, interrupt the security cameras in this place if you can.
Why?
Because I don't think we want footage of whatever is about to happen.
Oh.
Jill began working to kill the surveillance before things went completely batshit. At the bar, everyone had just finished getting their drinks. Rich and Nick were absorbed in a discussion about the finer points of his talents.
Yeah, holding it isn't that hard. Setting it up is the only part that takes much effort.
Vince and Selena noticed Alice approaching. Alex and Mary sensed the white-hot rage emanating from Alice's mind. But there was no time to stop her.
And after that, it's not much worse
you
than...
You bastard!
Rich looked up from the floor, trying to sort out what had just happened. Then he curled up on his side, clutching his stomach.
Do you think that's funny? Do you think that's fucking funny?
Alice reared back for another kick.
Alice, stop!
Calm down!
Alice could feel someone pulling her back by the shoulders and noticed the stares of all the strangers around her. She did not give any semblance of a fuck. Alice was a focused inferno, just begging for release. She raised her long, elegant leg and slammed her red high-heeled pump into Rich's ribcage. Every suspended light within 20 feet of Alice had broken off, dropped, and shattered on the floor. Alice had barely registered what had just happened as she fought to get in one more shot.
Alice, that's enough!
Chad was in front of her, staring her down. He didn't make any move to touch her, but it was evident anything she sent at Rich would be blocked. With the bulk of her rage spent and her target cut off from her, Alice finally felt the emotional weight she'd been trying to push back. She turned and collapsed into Nick's shoulders.
Nick, Vince, get Alice outside. We'll catch up in a minute.
The pirate in sunglasses and the silver-haired vampire gently escorted the devil in the black corset through the remaining crowd. Few people noticed her in the still bubbling confusion, and those that did assumed she'd been struck by one of the lights. Mary turned her attention to Rich, who was trying to lift himself from the floor while favoring his damaged ribs. Camille stepped forward and reached out. Mary saw in her thoughts that she was going to heal him.
Don't help him.
Mary had to make a conscious effort not to lose her temper, too. They'd drawn far too much attention as it was. One more curious event could get them booted from the HCP.
What the fuck was her problem?
Rich had blood on his teeth, probably from Alice's first punch.
Rich, I heard Alice's thoughts when she was attacking you. I know what went on in her dream. I sent Nick and Vince out of the room because if they knew too, I'm afraid they might genuinely try to kill you.
Rich stared up at her as the rest of his team closed in around them.
I'm going to tell you what she was mad about, and so help me God, if Alex and I pick up one mental twinge that you had something to do with it, I'll make you regret the day you set foot on Lander's campus. In Alice's dream, she was approached by a man she didn't know, who told her that he was a friend of her mother's.
Chad shook his head.
I don't see the issue here.
Alice's mother died when she was a baby. Yet this man, this stranger who appeared in the scenario Rich constructed for her, said she was still alive and very much wanted to see her daughter.
What?
A burst of panic tore through Rich's mind. It was a sensation heavy with fear. But the fear wasn't of Mary or Alex. She wondered, what scared him more than a pair of righteously pissed-off telekinetics?
I swear, I had nothing to do with that. I just stuck her in her subconscious. I didn't add anything.
His mind supported the story. There was shock and uncertainty at what could have gone awry. Mary turned to Alex.
Anything?
Nope.
Mary turned back to see Chad hauling Rich slowly to his feet.
I'm very sorry for whatever Alice experienced. I hope you've seen that Rich had nothing to do with it, at least not intentionally. We're all still learning, and it's possible for mistakes to be made.
Yes, as far as we can tell, he didn't know about it.
Good.
Chad rested his hand on Rich's shoulder.
Because I am certain no member of my team would intentionally do anything as horrible as playing on the emotional wounds of someone who had lost a parent.
No, definitely not.
Mary heard another cluster of fear-soaked thoughts scatter through Rich's brain. She noticed that, while Chad's hand might seem to be there for support, his fingers were digging rather forcefully into his teammate's shoulder.
I can absolutely assure you that such a thing will never happen again, accidentally or otherwise.
Mary couldn't read Chad's mind, and she didn't have Nick's talents for seeing through people. But it was still plain that Chad knew exactly the same kind of pain as Alice. She hoped that Rich really was innocent, as Chad believed him to be. Otherwise, he was likely in for a pretty horrible couple of hours.
We should probably go. We can still slip out like we're scared, but if we stay much longer, people are gonna start asking about the fight.
Alex is right. Let's call it a night.
I agree.
The group broke into clusters of twos and threes before heading to the doors. Rich tried to get alongside Camille, but Chad's guiding hand kept him directly next to his captain. Together, the boys headed out into the cold night. Everyone dispersed except for Mary, Camille, and Herschel, who found the two boys and Alice at the side of the black brick building. Together, they piled into cars and headed toward home, finally ending what most of them thought was just another shitty Halloween.
Sounds like quite an eventful night.
Mr. Numbers studied the board for a moment and then moved his pawn.
That's one heck of an understatement.
Mary's eyes swept over each chess piece as she contemplated possible moves.
When we got home, Alice barely stayed awake long enough for Camille to heal her hand. She passed out on the couch. Poor thing was completely wiped. I had to carry her to her room.
How nice of you.
To be honest, I was a little thankful she fell asleep. I didn't even know what to say to her at the time. Plus, I was drained from some other stuff.
Mary moved her rook a few spaces up. She'd lose it in two moves. But if she was lucky, it would give her an opening.
Other stuff?
Mr. Numbers moved his bishop, setting his own trap for when Mary attempted to spring the one she was haphazardly constructing.
Yeah, other stuff.
Mary and Nick had shared some brief words, mostly agreement that what had been seen in his mind was to stay between the two of them. Other than that, he had kept his distance for the rest of the evening. Of course, Alice had needed tending to, and in her distraught state, she'd barely released Nick for any extended period of time. Still, Mary had a feeling she would need to have a talk with Nick before long. What she'd learned was simply too huge not to affect their friendship. That would come in time. Currently, she had bigger concerns. Mr. Numbers watched Mary move a pawn, sealing the outcome of the game. He'd have her in five moves.
So, have you talked to her about the other aspect of the incident?
Mary shook her head.
She's been asleep or pretending to be asleep all morning. I'm not even sure what we do about it.
You should talk to the dean. He'll direct you to the appropriate course. I assure you, supers discovering new aspects of their abilities is hardly unheard of in the HCP.
Mr. Numbers moved his bishop.
I guess so. She might want to keep it a secret for a little while, at least until she gets a handle on it.
Mary moved another pawn quickly, hoping to step up the pace of the game and lure him into a mistake.
Trust me. If the dean isn't already aware of Alice's new light-smashing developments, he will be soon. The man has been actively keeping an eye on you five.
Is that your way of saying you'll tell him if we don't?
Yes.
Mary cocked an eyebrow. It was rare to get such a straightforward answer from Mr. Numbers.
That seems a bit like prying into our business.
Mr. Transport and I are your caretakers. Prying is one of the main parts of the job description.
Mr. Numbers moved his knight, taking Mary's rook.
That said, I would report this information even if it wasn't about one of our charges. Alice needs to get training, and she needs it as soon as possible. For a regular super or a powered, an uncontrolled ability is already dangerous. but for someone in the HCP, it is utterly unacceptable.
I suppose you're right. I can see how Alice might hurt someone without meaning to.
Mary sent her second rook into the fray, taking one of Mr. Number's pawns in the process.
Someone or herself?
Fine, you made your point. How would I even reach him on a Saturday?
I have a number you can call to set up an appointment.
Mr. Numbers moved his queen into position, preparing for the final blow.
I'll get Alice and call after the game is over.
Then I suggest you get the phone. We don't have long to go.
Don't go counting me out until it's over.
She was beaten in two more moves. She wasn't surprised, not really. She never came close to beating Mr. Numbers. But Mary wisely understood that losing could still teach a person quite a bit. So, she persisted in her weekly habit of getting clobbered, despite any sense of progress. Meanwhile, Alice lay in her bed, staring at the ceiling. She knew that once she was up, her day had to begin. That meant that she would need to talk to the professors about the crashing lights, because, while she was skeptical she had the ability to do something like that, it seemed far too big of a coincidence to ignore. She'd probably have to find Rich and apologize at some point, and she might owe Nick a new shirt. She was fairly certain the makeup she'd had on last night would stain most materials when combined with tears. All of these were reasons she was still under the covers, despite the slowly rising sun, but they weren't the main one. Alice had had a brief taste of hope that her mother was alive, and it would evaporate when she got up. There was no room for such childish delusions in the cold wastelands of the real world.
Alice, are you up yet?
Of course it was Mary coming by to check on her, to help make things right. That was what Mary did. Alice just kept staring at the ceiling.
We've got an appointment with Dean Blaine in an hour. I'll come back in 15 minutes, but if you're still asleep, I'll have to wake you up.
Alice wondered how she'd make good on that threat.
She'll find a way, no doubt about that.
She glanced at the digital clock, 10 a.m. That meant they needed to be in the office at 11. She could keep wasting time here and throw herself together at the last minute, or she could get up and put on her armor. Mascara, blush, eyeshadow, heels, straightened hair, an hour of effort to appear as if she were effortlessly beautiful. Alice didn't need all of that. She was naturally gorgeous. She did it because it made her feel stronger, like she had some control over the world around her. And she needed to feel stronger today. She needed it very badly. Alice swung her feet over the edge of her bed and plopped them onto the floor. Then, she set about getting ready for the day ahead.
You'll find their complete recollections of the incident in the packets, along with some footage I confiscated from a few cell phones.
Dean Blaine slid the manila envelope across his desk. Professor Hill picked it up. He scanned through the few documents quickly, noting that there was a USB drive taped to the inner back of the envelope.
Confiscated, huh? You told them they'd accidentally caught something classified, I assume.
Something like that.
Kind of you, especially considering that what happened could almost be looked upon as a violation of the secret identity rule.
You have an objection?
Not at all. You know that. I'm just bringing up a point that someone else will raise eventually.
If they do, I'll simply remind them that the rule is designed to keep our students in line when dealing with regular humans, not punish them for having the misfortune to make a discovery about their abilities while in public. Miss Adair's ferocious beating of Mr. Weaver aside, she didn't intend for the gravity spasm to occur. She's never experienced anything like it before, and couldn't have intentionally summoned it if she tried.
Blake Hill looked back at the file.
Gravity manipulation. Given her genetics, I always suspected that's where her flight came from.
Hope is not the same thing as suspicion. Besides, nothing is confirmed yet. It could be an aspect of Mr. Weaver's abilities that manifested in distress.
Yeah, right. We both know that's unlikely. He did have good reason to be distressed, I'll say that. I'm surprised by how much damage she did. Maybe you need to pull her from subtlety and stick her in close combat.
Mm-hmm. I'm sure you'd like to see me redistribute the bulk of Professor Pendleton's students in such a fashion.
You and I both know that that specialty is all trouble. The last person you had teaching it was an undercover kidnapper. The most qualified person to replace her is a convict. I think that says it all.
Subtlety walks a dangerous line. I won't disagree with you there. Not all the heroes who turn to crime have their concentration in it, however. Raze and George were both specialized in close combat, and Globe got his HCP major in control, just like you.
Three examples. The mass of them still come from subtlety.
Subtlety is an established part of the HCP agenda. I have neither the power nor the inclination to remove it. As for Professor Pendleton, I heard your objections when I offered him the job. They were weighed and considered before I made my decision. Now I'd suggest you worry less about his class and more about how you'll assist your own student.
Whatever you say, boss. I'll start by helping her figure out how to access that part of her ability. What did Rich do to piss her off so much, anyway?
Dean Blaine hesitated. He needed to approach this carefully.
He sealed her, along with Mr. Campbell and Ms. Smith, to prove a point. Miss Adair experienced a rather upsetting vision while incapacitated, and thought Mr. Weaver had inflicted it on her purposefully. All current investigations point to that not being the case. So at the end of the day, it was a simple misunderstanding that got out of hand.
What was her vision?
I believe it was something about her mother. A false hope her brain cobbled together. Completely understandable given her past.
Dean Blaine watched Professor Hill carefully, eyes searching for any signs of repressed anger. He saw an initial flare-up, which simmered down as reason stepped in.
I see. And we're sure it wasn't Rich?
Multiple telepaths confirmed he was surprised by the revelation.
Well, I don't think I'll use that route for training, but it's good to know at least.
Professor Hill rose from his seat, clutching the file tightly in his hand.
She's expecting to stay after class on Monday, right?
Correct.
Good. Thanks for the heads up and everything.
Thank you for coming in to meet me on a weekend.
Professor Hill gave a curt nod and headed for the door.
I wonder what those Melbrook kids are going to throw at me next.
Monday brought, along with an extra class for Alice, a pre-class gathering for all the sophomores. They clustered together in the gym, milling about while the teachers took their damn sweet time in making whatever announcement was pending. Most already suspected they knew the subject matter. Given that they'd just crested the hill into November, the only pertinent thing looming was midterms. After last year's labyrinth, the room was rife with rumors. Some believed the test would be a team match, pitting them against a professor. Others speculated it would be a solo endeavor, featuring grueling mental and physical punishment. Most assumed it would at least suck, and the ones who didn't were among the few who hadn't yet been significantly challenged by any of the tests the HCP had presented.
Good morning, everyone.
Dean Blaine stepped forward, leaving the six professors slightly behind him.
I just had a quick announcement to make. I'm sure most of you are wondering when your midterms will be. Well, as far as the HCP goes, there will not be any. I can see you're all skeptical. While that's a good thing, in this case, it is unwarranted. You see, we don't do midterms for sophomores for two reasons. First, the midterms for students in other years are very time-consuming to set up. So much so that adding a fourth to our schedule would likely be impossible. Second, all the team events that sophomores participate in give us ample data for evaluation, so adding a test in the middle of the year wouldn't make much difference either way, and would only be a poor use of time and resources. So, enjoy the free pass. It will be the only year you receive it, and I expect your grades in other classes to pick up proportionately. That will be all.
Dean Blaine turned away, and the chorus of whispers he had been expecting finally materialized. They still wouldn't accept it for a while, and a few would spend the next month and a half waiting for a surprise test that would never come. He hoped they'd put this free time to good use. Year two was the last time they'd really get to stop and catch their breath. And when they did, they'd find their chests had grown tight with fear of what would happen if they failed. A fear that would only grow stronger the nearer they drew to graduation. Blaine stood out on the balcony wishing he could smoke. He'd burned a few in high school, but he'd given up that habit after his first week in the HCP. The workouts were hard enough without a diminished lung capacity. His fingers still itched for a cigarette, especially when he was stressed or had the taste of bourbon in his mouth. He wondered if the cravings would ever completely go away. They said it happened eventually, but they said a lot of things that turned out to be bullshit. Blaine felt the cool air waft out from the apartment. Clarissa's place had an amazing view, but the price was standing in the unseasonable heat. It was still early summer, yet Blaine was certain he'd sweated through his shirt and that only his suit jacket was concealing it. He wondered if that was the real purpose of a suit jacket in the first place.
Man, you've got the right idea. I need a little fresh air. That place is too loud and stuffy.
Joshua looked over the city with him. He was one of Blaine's classmates in the HCP, as was everyone else inside the apartment. All except one. That one was part of why he stood on the balcony suppressing a craving instead of socializing with everyone else.
Hard to believe that in a few weeks, we'll all be going different directions.
Mm-hmm.
Any idea who you'll be apprenticing under?
There aren't any official offers made until after graduation.
Come on, man. You and I both know you'll be one of the 10. You can't tell me you haven't gotten a few feelers already.
There may have been some inquiries. Gina Gong and Gray Earl have been particularly persistent.
Wow, those two are pretty impressive. All I've gotten so far is a vague interest from Shade Slime.
More'll come after the test.
Yeah, maybe. I'm not exactly the most impressive of our lot, power-wise.
Joshua was right, but only because of the tremendous crop of talent their class had yielded. Besides, what Joshua might lack in showmanship, he made up for in reliability and charm. He had a knack for turning everyone into a friend, and given the competitiveness of their environment, that was almost more useful than his actual power.
I'm positive you'll get a solid offer. I can't imagine anyone underestimating you once they see what you can do.
I'll hope for the best. That's all any of us can do.
Joshua pulled a flask from his pocket, carefully unscrewed the top, and offered it to Blaine.
Care for a nip? Clarissa stocked some good wine, but I know you prefer bourbon.
Blaine didn't bother asking why he would have a flask of bourbon on hand. The answer was evident. It was to please the woman Joshua had brought to the party, the one Blaine had introduced to bourbon in the first place. He accepted the flask.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Blaine handed the flask back, and Joshua took his own sip. He regarded the flask intently for a moment, frowning slightly.
Look, not to make this uncomfortable or anything, but I just wanted to make sure you and I are cool.
Blaine bit back a scathing retort and got his temper under control. He didn't have any right to be vindictive, not when Joshua had been so honest and forthright with him from the beginning.
Of course we are. Miriam and I broke up over 3 years ago. I'm glad the two of you have found happiness with one another.
I appreciate that, Blaine. I really like her. I think we might have a future together. Let me know if it gets awkward, though, okay? I don't have to bring her to all of our events if it makes you uncomfortable.
I will make certain to tell you if that becomes an issue.
Blaine knew he would cut out his own tongue before he'd actually speak those words.
Cool.
Joshua took another sip from the flask.
Cool.
Did Gerard have any trouble scrubbing the tea stain out?
Blaine was unabashedly changing the subject. He'd had a small incident during Clarissa's serving ceremony, which resulted in him spilling tea on Gerard's pants. He'd said it was because of the heat of the cup, but the truth was, he'd seen Miriam grab Joshua's thigh, and the rush of emotion had overwhelmed his coordination.
He got most of it. I think a good dry cleaner can fix the rest. Once you do graduate, maybe your hero name should be Butterfingers.
Or the fumbler.
Spiltacular. On that note, have you given any thought to your actual hero name? We'll have to register them right after the white cape ceremony.
I've got a couple ideas I've been kicking around. You?
Honestly, I've got an idea. But I keep waffling back and forth on whether I should come up with something better.
You've still got a month.
True. Hopefully I'll find some inspiration. Tell me one of yours. Maybe it'll get the creative juices flowing.
Well, I haven't found one that seems perfect yet, but there are a few near the top. For example, you know how my ability affects an area around my body?
Yeah.
I was thinking of doing a play on that. At first, I considered radius, or sphere, but those sounded too mathematical. Then one day I was sitting in class, and it hit me. The perfect name for how my power encircles me. Globe.
Thomas hunched over his kitchen table, a large piece of paper with multiple written entries beside him and a laptop directly in front of him. His other roommates were there as well, their own checklists in hand.
Okay, so we found a good deal on some kegs. We've located a place two towns over that sells plastic cups in bulk. And we've alerted our neighbors to the impending disturbance. What's next?
Food.
We have to feed them, too?
You guys really haven't been to many parties.
It was a point Violet had made at least once an hour. She'd been shocked when Thomas told her he'd been tasked with throwing the party the freshmen were invited to, and even more floored when he said he'd decided to do it. Despite having dated him for a few months, there were times when Violet felt she never really knew him.
You need food to help people sober up if they've overshot their limits. You know, things like pretzels and bread to help soak up the booze.
Will shook his head.
That's actually a common myth. Food that is already in the stomach before alcohol is consumed can affect the rate of absorption. However, once the alcohol has been ingested, taking in food would have no discernible effect. It is simple biology.
Fair enough, but you just said yourself it's a common myth, right?
Indeed.
Then people who believe it will help make them less intoxicated could very likely see those effects since they're expecting them. Same as sugar pills in place of painkillers.
Ah, you're referencing the placebo effect.
It is simple psychology.
Point taken.
Other men of Will's intelligence might have bristled at being bested by a girl who specialized in brawn over brains. But Will had long ago learned that intelligence in one area didn't make him infallible in others. He was a mechanic. He looked at the body like a machine and often forgot the less tangible components the mind could present.
I believe we can get sandwiches from the Mayo Hut at a sizable discount, thanks to the owner's infatuation with my sister.
Stella smirked at Will.
Pimping your own sister to the cause. Now, that's dedication.
It is something of a family tradition to place one another in uncomfortable situations. Besides, with as much patronage as she gives that establishment, I'd think it only good business to give her preferential treatment.
Jill does love her sandwiches. So we'll let her take care of that, and I can pick up a few jumbo bags of pretzels from the same place we're getting the cups from.
Thomas scratched a long line through one of the items on his paper as Will jotted down the details of his new task.
What's next?
Guest list.
Nope, I don't think we pick and choose. I'll spread the word through the freshman class, and anyone who's brave enough to show up is welcome. That's how Angela did it, and I feel it worked quite well.
I'd agree, but I wasn't talking about the freshmen.
Violet looked at her friends and carefully framed her next words.
Look, there's a bit of an elephant in the room, and we need to talk about it. Are we going to invite the powers to this thing?
They're not...
I know they aren't, Thomas, but you get what I mean.
I thought we agreed at the beginning of the year to treat them with the same friendship they've shown us.
Stella and Will nodded in agreement.
Yes, we did, and I still think we should. But despite the fact that we are throwing it, this party isn't really about us. It's about the freshmen and introducing them to the Lander community as a whole.
All the more reason to show them that we are accepting of people who may come from different backgrounds than ourselves. We will set the standard for them to follow.
We are accepting. We being the key word. But not everyone else is, and they may not want to socialize with people who started life as cowards. It's prejudice and ignorance, but there's a lot of unspoken dislike for those five, even if we choose to ignore it. Now, if it was just us putting together a shindig, I'd say fuck them if they don't like our friends. But again, this is about the freshmen. And what impression do you think they'll take from a party populated solely by the people who live in the house and the school's pariahs?
She makes a valid point. We're supposed to be bringing them into the larger community of supers. Inviting the residents of Melbrook could very well limit that community.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.